Well, welcome to Fundraising Theatre, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the show. It's delightful to see so many of you here, and this truly is something different. This is going to be something that is going to touch your senses in ways that you've never experienced before. It's hundreds of hours from volunteers, professional teams, and it's all designed to challenge you. It's designed to take you on a journey which actually will make you think differently about what you do in your fundraising and perhaps even your everyday life. So what we're going to be doing, ladies and gentlemen, is taking you through a very simple framework. It's called the alphabet. And what we're going to try and do in the next 2.5 hours of presentation, yes, you did hear that correctly, is we're actually going to try to give you some of the key thoughts, the key tools that we believe you need to be a successful fundraiser, not only in Canada, but in the world today. So ladies and gentlemen, on that thought, let's begin, and let's begin with affinity. I believe we need to do more to create a tribal brand for being a fundraiser, because that's what I am and always will be. You see, when you talk about branding, you cannot in this day and age do a presentation without talking about this, can you? At this moment, I can see the backs of iPads pointing at me in a demon-like way. And you see, some people go to extremes. Some people say, I love this brand so much, I'm going to have it shaved into my head. How bizarre is that? But what about you, ladies and gentlemen? What about you? How many people in this room have got the logo of their charity and their cause on their body right now? Hands up. Right now. You thought about that, didn't you? Going, a badge doesn't count. There was no pain involved in that badge. There really was. Hello.
Hello, Tony. Are you giving us heck?
Yeah, basically.
Shame on you.
Why? That's
because
what I expect.
Because I think that fundraisers are a tribe, and
you
they're proud of it.
Okay.
And you don't think anybody
so
has
you're
a
so
tattoo?
Smart, and you've got the AFP tattooed on your body?
Well, not quite the AFP, but I do have this.
Okay. Right. You've got... Right, okay. Andrea, this could be a bit embarrassing. Sorry about this. Oh, my God. Respect! Respect! Wow! Okay, I'll give it to you. Thanks, darling.
You're welcome.
All right. Woo! Actually, excuse me, I might... No. Okay. Sorry. Dreadful.
This is my profile picture on Facebook, and I'm showing my connection to the brand Pink Ribbon, and I'm telling the world that I care about this. And this is a blogger that chose to wear the pink ribbon on her blog and showing the world that she cares about this cause. Or like this, showing your respect for the veterans by wearing the poppy on your twibbons. So this takes us to our next letter, and this is B, and it stands for breast. What do you think is the most special thing about this cause?
You know, people ask me this question a lot, and when I do, I frequently show them images like these. What do you see here? Do you see a pink ribbon, or do you see a community of people? You see, the power of breast cancer cause is not found in the pink ribbon, but it's found in a participating community who are personally touched and emotionally connected to the cause. There are some great organizations, and some of them are really edgy, and they're communicating in new ways. You want to see one?
Hi, I'm Dr. Rutherford Gray, and it's come to my attention that many women aren't checking regularly for breast cancer. I'd love to discuss how we can change that. But since studies have shown that women are more likely to watch a video if it features a hot guy, I'm not going to. He is.
Hey, I'm Anthony, and I'm here to talk to you about Rethink Breast Cancer's Your Man Reminder. It's an app that gives you regular reminders to check your breasts from a hot guy of your choice.
Hey there. How you doing? Hey, baby.
I love that video.
I love it too, but for a different reason.
I'm sexy and I know it. I'm sexy and I know it.
Years ago, 9-year-old Jack Yielding began selling lemonade on his driveway to raise money for the hospital for sick children. He had been a patient at Sick Kids himself, undergoing a number of brain surgeries for his epileptic seizures, and wanted to help other patients now that he was better.
One day when he was 4 there for a treatment of his own, he noticed another child in the hallway and said that he wanted to help.
Who wants lemonade?
Jack's lemonade stand has evolved since the early days. What began as a small event on his driveway, featured in Susan Hayes' Making a Difference, has become quite the fundraiser with live music, activity stations, even a petting zoo. This year's event attracted upwards of 2,000 people.
An amazing story, ladies and gentlemen, Jack's lemonade stand. And I'm delighted to say today we've got Jack's mum here, Jody. Jody, hello, darling.
Hi, Tony. I thought by this point you're probably thirsty, and that you'd probably be thirsty for some lemonade.
That seems like a good start. Thank you. Jody, thanks very much for joining us today. I mean, amazing. This story has reached around the world. We've heard about it in the UK. And one of the big things for me is, tell me what this has meant to Jack.
Well, you know, Tony, Jack is now 10, and he's had to endure more in his short life than most people do in a lifetime. It's been about 3 years since he had a significant portion of his brain removed. His recovery, in part, involved him relearning how to talk, relearning how to walk. And throughout all of this, for him to feel so proud because of the community through his lemonade stand and to feel like he's truly making a difference and to be a successful entrepreneur, it's just been incredible for him. And last night, as I was tucking him into bed and was telling him about this morning, and I said, what's the very best part about your lemonade stand? And he said, it makes me feel so special. So it's so sweet, and it's just so genuine. So it's just amazing when a community comes together and can believe in kids, what can be done.
Tell me about the other kids. What has Jack's example meant to other kids in the community and around Canada? What's your sense of that?
Well, it's incredible. Now the event has grown to have over 2,000 people coming out annually, and we always have at least 50 to 75 kids pre-registered, many of whom are patients themselves at SickKids, saying, what can I do to help? I want to be part of this. And now there's also other satellite lemonade stands at schools, different initiatives. So I think Jack's lemonade stand is really a story about showing kids that despite illness and disability, it doesn't need to be a barrier to achievement, and that indeed kids can make a difference. And I think with kids being able to make a difference like this, the very least us adults can do is say, what can we do to help?
That's fantastic. I mean, the other day when I came over, the thing that really struck me about this story is that Jody said, well, bring the lemonade stand along. He said, oh, and by the way, Jack said he can't be with you today because he's at school, but here's his business card. Like, unbelievable.
Woo! Banana! Woo!
Thank you very much indeed. What we've done there in just a couple of minutes is we've reunited the two sides of the force. Now, if George Lucas had done that, nobody would have given a tinker's cuss about one of the biggest movie franchises in history. But we've known since the days of Socrates that to get a story over, we have to break it down into three parts. We need the fabled beginning, the middle, and the end. Act one, we meet the hero. We find out what lies in store for him or her. Act two, we see them overcome the obstacles, win battles. And finally, we see whether they succeed or if they fail. It's a fantastic system, but why don't we use it in fundraising? I don't know. We have the best stories ever. And we often use them in our mailing packs. We present somebody in need of help, and we'll actually show what's needed to help them. The donor will send their gift in, and that's it. They won't hear any more about that person. That person may as well be dead to them. And for me, what we need to do is we've got to move away from that. We've got to start looking at a different approach, because if we just let stories end like that, it's like somebody coming in 20 minutes before the end of a film and turning the TV off. It's so frustrating. So the approach that I would suggest is, let's not look at our fundraising campaigns as lots of individual packs. What would happen if we put them in one great big emotional story?
I have a special guest waiting just off stage. All the way from the planet Dagobah, I give you, ladies and gentlemen, my Lord Yoda. Oh! At the heart of our story, the donor is the hero. When they read your appeals, they read about themselves. And that's where true emotional engagement lies. And for us, we're back off to defeat the dark side.
Danielle Harrison from Snesbury will wake up this morning to her 71st day of lying in a bath of cold baked beans. You can donate by calling 08459 897 233.
And every time it rains, fairest room of heaven.
Shooby dooby.
Don't you know each cloud contains fairest room of heaven?
Shooby dooby.
You'll find your fortune falling all over town. Be sure that your umbrella is upside down and trade them for a package of sunshine and ravioli.
Macaroni!
If you want the things you love, you must have a pizzaoli, baby. And when you hear thunder, don't run under a tree. There'll be pennies from heaven for you and me. Now come over here, boy, Sam. And every time it rains. And don't you know it's crocodiles? Every time it rains, don't you know it's crocodiles? You find your fortune falling. All over town, all over town, all over town. Be sure that your umbrella is upside down, we live up. How about the hills of white?
So, donor fatigue, what are you thinking?
Well, you know, Mark, one of the things I think is that donors have every reason to be tired because, as all of you know out there, all of you who are donors, you know that change takes time. Every day you get bad news. And sometimes you just wonder whether you make a difference. So the last thing we expect fundraisers to do is to add what is actually very legitimate fatigue that the world's taking too long to get better. So this kind of thing just makes me mad.
I get that, but I got to tell you, I actually think donor fatigue is caused by us fundraisers. I mean, I got a solicitation from Mitt Romney. Okay? I mean, you know, anybody who knows me, if they looked at their database, Mitt Romney? See one? No way. It's like, get the database together. Don't act like you don't know me.
And donor fatigue, I mean, who gets shopping fatigue? If they send me one more sale on shoes, I sat down where I started to do my best thinking, and I made a list of things that get me tired and fatigued. It's quite a lot of stuff here. The government, and they're telling us that we can use 10% to talk about issues, but if we do, we're terrorists and they'll defund us.
Well, and so then you've got nonprofits who won't do anything when it comes to advocacy or public policy because they're so damn afraid. Now, as a donor, I'm really into public policy and advocacy, and I want my nonprofit to be doing things like that to make change because it's not just the, you know, help the kids, it's the larger social issues.
No, it's really important that the things we put in front of these people pulse with passion, radiate with hope, make them feel that their gift is making a difference, and we just can't bombard them, was your word, Mark, into submission.
And thanking people. I think that's what really causes people to get tired, when they don't get thanked before they get asked again, and nobody ever tells them whether that well in Africa ever got drilled. I've been drilling wells in Africa for 35 years. You think they're going to get the water soon?
They're deep wells, Ken.
Had a client who asked me, do you think it's okay if we only thank donors of $250 and above? I didn't know what to say, other than, are you nuts?
This is the good stuff. This is what I want.
How about the thank you that takes forever?
Get them off.
Well, oh, yeah,
come, right? So,
I give you the same thank you.
Oh, yeah, right.
Just get him off. everybody make some noise!
Whoa! So what is all that about? That is about griller. That is about urban. That is about real. And you see, nowadays, you need energy in marketing. Many of you in this room know that I believe passionately in griller marketing. And if you look at this behind you, look at the messaging that we receive. Do you know nowadays, they actually calculate that we get between 3 and 20,000 messages a day? That, ladies and gentlemen, is outrageous. And your job is to punch above it. Your job is to get through. So how do you do it? I love this. This basically was a company wanting to launch new underwear. They sneaked up one morning and on one of the most iconic statues in New York, this is what they did. How much publicity do you think they got for the coolest underwear in the city? Quite a lot. You see, the thing is that guerrilla marketing is very much about creating word of mouth. How do you create a vibe? How do you get out there? How do you actually create something? Well, the number one rule is brain power. You need to use your brain. You need to absolutely really push yourself to the limits. And if you think about it, it's not about budget, it is about brain. We're never gonna have the budget, not in your wildest dream. It's also about time and patience. This stuff takes dedication. This stuff takes consistency. This is about your brand. The smart ones in this room will go and do this. They won't just laugh and walk out the room. The smart ones will make it personal to their donors, and the smart ones know there's another golden rule, don't you? You need audacity and you need cojones. Because if you haven't got those, you'll just say it will never get past the board.
Tony, what on earth are you doing? You can't get into the brains of humans dressed like that. You're okay. Not ready to do serious research. Go get gowned up.